Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. My name is Tchetvertakov. This is the fourth in the series of presentations or webinars that we as a company are providing for clients. Today's topic is the roundup of weekly events, and I'll just be discussing a few points that are particularly important as of this week in foreign exchange and generally financial markets, but with specific focus on foreign exchange. So I just like to make sure if everyone's able to hear me. If you would like to ask questions, please just enter them into the questions box, and I will try to answer them before the end of this session. I'll try and keep this fairly brief. I mean, this week has not been too eventful, but there are a few points we'll be talking about. So we should roughly take, instead of the normal 1 hour schedule, we'll probably take around half an hour, and I'll give you guys some questions as well. So just to start off with, just to give you an idea of what actually is happening this week, if you look on in front of your screens here, you should see the weekly performance in G20 FX currencies. G20 FX this week, and as you can see, the vast strength has been seen in the dollar and the yen this week, primarily because of, again, the European situation is kind of getting worse, with no resolution yet to be seen, and financial markets actually, my personal opinion, they are starting to discount or starting to price in the possibility of a European breakup and various countries leaving the European Monetary Union. And as a result of that, we're seeing safe haven flows into the US dollar and the yen, and not so much the Swiss franc. Swiss franc, again, the story on the Swiss franc is that in futures rates and forward markets are predicting a negative yields in Swiss assets, i.e. over the next 12 months, we're actually going to see yields in Swiss franc fall below zero. And so we will be likely to see a somewhat slower level of buying of the Swiss franc, and also some profit taking in it as well, because a lot of long Swiss positions have been speculative. But generally, what else happened this week? Well, the big news big UK news this week, but the Bank of England inflation report essentially has opened the door for more quantitative easing. We've seen severe sterling weakness in every currency pair, generally against the yen. In particular, roughly 2.5% down on the week against the yen. Again, that was fairly predictable. I remember even in Tuesday sessions when I was covering the psychology of FX trading, we spoke about sterling yen briefly. And generally, yes, Mervyn King didn't surprise positively at all. Yeah, it was a very negative meeting with negative comments, with forecasts being revised down from 2% growth in 2012 down to 1%. And in 2013, from 3% down to 2.5%. So again, more negative revisions. So revisions lower in growth, and that's taken sterling lower. The likelihood of interest rates rising in the UK has been stretched further back. And thus, we're in a situation where, again, there's probably more sterling weakness we're probably going to see more sterling weakness from here until we see strong European solution, or market participants at least perceive there to be a strong solution. So in terms of quantitative easing, I think in the UK there was kind of loose expectations around, like in my personal conversations I've had with various brokers and banks, is that generally the expectations for next week, from this week's inflation report, were that quantitative easing would not be a priority, i.e. would potentially be something that would be explored in 2012, maybe February, March, maybe April of next year. Well, now the expectations for quantitative easing have significantly come closer. We're likely to see quantitative easing maybe even before the end of this year. And that, again, would also be very sterling negative. But the kind of the bigger picture overall in the UK is that kind of the consumer sector. For me, what I took out most from the inflation report and generally the UK situation is that consumers' real incomes are being squeezed, unemployment is rising, consumer confidence is not very, it's still low. It hasn't actually risen all that significantly since 2008, 2009, when you compare today's levels to those of 2008. So I think overall consumer spending is like this kind of stay flat, and so and fall, or to stay at least suppressed. We aren't likely to see, unless we see a change of policy. So, for example, we could see sort of government action. So, if government policy changes and helps sort of the economic outlook, that there is one possibility. But for now, there isn't anything really out there that kind of to lift sentiment and optimism in the UK internally. Kind of in other news, we also had Japanese yen. The Bank of Japan held rates at exceptional levels of 0.1%. They've held that rate there as expected, and asset purchases were maintained at roughly 55 trillion yen. So again, there's nothing all too much new from Japan, although yes, we just get more confirmation that they're there as they were, more or less. And so the strength we're seeing, although it's a very dovish central bank at the moment in Japan, the strength we're seeing is more to do with risk aversion rather than, let's say, Japanese strength or Japanese, let's say, health. A couple of other things I would say really grabbed my attention this week are, okay, I've had a couple of comments from rating agencies and calling up policymakers. So the real two big issues for me are, Fitch, kind of they had a comment, and I'll read it for you word for word. It was, unless the euro area debt crisis is resolved in a timely and orderly manner, the broad credit outlook for the US banking industry could worsen. So essentially, we're looking at a possibility of the European problem, or the European sovereign debt problem, again spilling over into the US and almost having a side-by-side debt issue in US and Europe at the same time. So so far we've kind of had one versus the other. So we've had European problems versus American relative strength, and it will go from kind of swing from 1 week, so from US strength to US weakness from 1 week to the next. If we do see kind of a simultaneous worsening of sentiment and conditions in US and Europe, that could really be extremely volatile for euro dollar. The euro dollar currency pair will be extremely volatile, and that's going to drive other currency pairs. Saying so, volatility overall across the board in all markets is going to be much higher. And for retail traders such as yourselves, day traders such as yourselves, is going to be a lot of opportunities, but also a lot of risk for you there. So that's also worth remembering. Another thing which is kind of grabbed my attention was the Japan. Just going back quickly to the Bank of Japan Central Bank meeting, in that they did mention yen strength. They haven't been mentioning the strength of the yen all that much in recent meetings. Although recent yen strength was clearly given rise to a re-inclusion of that of yen strength into their meeting policy notes. So I think intervention in a dollar-yen pair is a very fairly strong possibility. If we just take a look at a chart, I'll just show you a quick chart of dollar-yen and show you how that actually looks in practice. So if you see, if you look on your screen right now, you should be able to see dollar-yen pair. And as you can see, we're trading roughly around 77 level here. Although the intervention mark is generally to be believed around here, around 76, maybe 75 and a half, somewhere around in this region here. So between, I would say, 76.50 and 75.80, I think that's really the danger zone for intervention. I think my personal view, if we see that area tested by the end of this week, although unlikely, but most probably not next week, we could potentially see intervention, something in the order of, or in the similar magnitude that we've seen in let me just annotate that for you, similar as we saw in August here, and also saw in November here, end of October here. So a similar candle with this magnitude was likely to be seen here. And in this particular case, when we're talking about intervention, the better strategy generally for trade intervention is generally to look to take sell positions at on the high rather than to get into long positions on the low. That's just kind of my personal view there. In broader terms, we are seeing kind of a return back to having kind of a risk off week this week. Generally, equities are generally lower. Commodity currency is generally lower. So generally, risk is not a huge. Generally, market participants are kind of risk averse. And just the last kind of point I would say in terms of what for me is again kind of very newsworthy and quite an important development, or let's say important re-highlighting of an important issue is the political issue, i.e. the kind of the ongoing political disagreement and a lack of cohesiveness in terms of between Germany and France. So that this issue has actually got worse over the last few days. So we're seeing sort of over the past couple of days or this week, we've seen several comments coming up from ECB officials, German officials, and French officials, and again, they're all very opposing to each other. So generally from French officials, we've seen comments to kind of going against further ECB intervention and going again, sorry, I beg your pardon, so France is actually going for further ECB intervention, looking for further bond purchases, and generally looking to take a US model or a fairly US US-led approach to actually increase asset purchases and increase the amount of liquidity in the market, and that is being opposed by Germany and German policymakers. And because the reason why this is so important is that Germany and France are the kind of the two nations that are leading the way in terms of rescuing the rest of Europe. So for them to have a disagreement, that is has become a huge as it has become very problematic for other asset classes and for other currency pairs specifically. So what we're generally seeing is that things like credit spreads, futures markets, and generally the expectations for the future are are very becoming more uncertain. Investors are seeing this disagreement, this political kind of disagreement, as something very incredibly important and a potential stumbling block for that cannot be overcome, essentially. So if France and Germany cannot agree on a specific path forward, again, we're likely to see more delays, more uncertainty, more volatility, and again, more selling at the end of the day, more equity selling, more safe haven buying, so more yen demand, more Swiss franc demand. And again, as I said, the euro-dollar pair is likely to be incredibly volatile. Wider spreads, et cetera, so that's definitely worth thinking about, and also going into a weekend, so considering the amount of policy risk we're seeing at the moment from potentially political effects and from market forces as well, so in my personal opinion, having a trade over this particular weekend is not maybe the best idea, given the amount of developments that could come out over this weekend. We could potentially see a very huge announcement regarding Europe or the US, given how much tension there is at the moment in credit markets in Europe, or CDS markets. So, for example, Italian yields, Greek yields are again at record high. So we haven't actually, although we're not seeing huge change, swings in prices, we are seeing fairly steady trading and fairly, I would even say, trending markets at the moment on a short-term basis. I wouldn't take that for granted, and I wouldn't sort of, I would always keep my eye on the fact that, yes, there is a huge amount of risk out there, a huge amount of tension out there at the moment, and that's why risk aversion is kind of the name of the game. So that's what the generally market participants are doing at the moment, or have been doing this week. Okay, that is more or less what for me has been quite an uneventful week, although a very eventful times, I would say, in the markets at the moment. So if you do have any questions, by all means, just put them into stick them in the questions box, and I'll try and answer them as best I can. Okay, we have a question from Philip Chan, and he's asking, would you comment on oil and gold? Okay. Just have a quick look. Let me just bring up a chart, gold chart. So we'll be looking at the gold spot rate. We're not going to concentrate on any futures markets or anything like that. So if in terms of the spot rate, for me, gold it's been on a very long-term downward upward trend. So we're talking like over several decades now. So the uptrend in gold, is going to remain. And again, with gold, whenever anyone asks me about gold, one thing that's never really changed, that's been the common denominator for me, is you should be looking to take really long positions on the lows, looking for dips into long positions. So, I know that's it's easier said than done, but for me, the technical picture and the fundamental picture are both saying the same, and that's gold strength from here. The only risk to that, risk to that view for me is a very strong resolution in Europe, and generally a risk kind of reversal in terms of risk sentiment. If investors really perceive risk sentiment to be improving, and Europe is not so much of a problem, if there is some kind of plan that kind of which the markets on the whole believe, then we're likely to see a sell-off in gold back towards kind of 1,500, 1,600, as we saw back in the late September. So, and that will be the time to take a long position. So, I mean, at the moment now, I think gold is a bit overpriced. There's a lot of negativity already priced into it. So, if you take long positions now and we get some good news, you're just going to be seriously offside, essentially. You're going to be literally waiting for that position to come around. So, my opinion from here is, if you think that things are going to get better, you're looking to go short. When I say things get better, I mean in terms of risk. So risk, if we're talking about the European sovereign debt problem, the U.S. fiscal issue. You know, for example, there are several very likely events that could happen in the next week or two. So let's say, for example, a French downgrade, a banking default, similar to Lehman Brothers. And one of these events could potentially happen, and that would be a very strong buy gold signal, and gold would likely to rise. But on the other hand, if you think back to 2008, gold actually suffered after Lehman collapse because of the strong dollar demand. So I think gold is very sensitive to actually what the dollar does. And considering that dollar funding rates are starting to rise, I wouldn't be so quick to buy gold if something risk averse happens. So I think gold is more of a longer term investment, and I wouldn't like to trade gold in these sort of uncertain times. Gold for me would be something I'd be looking to go on long. But in the longer term, and thus at the best possible level I can find in terms of a long position, rather than kind of trying to trade these really uncertain markets at the moment on gold, because gold is one of the most volatile products that we as a company offer, or generally as an asset class. So I would, for me, that's not really something I would trade on a short term basis. In terms of oil, let's have a look at the oil chart quickly. Yeah, so I'm just going to pull up an oil chart for you guys and let's have a look what we can see. Yeah, so I mean, at the moment, oil prices, again, we are kind of seeing oil prices kind of rise up as of October, generally trading around the $100 mark. I would say more or less, that's kind of been a fairly fair value for oil. I mean, I think it's going to stay around here, more around these levels. But the more important thing with oil, it is very sensitive to the dollar and very sensitive to risk again. So generally, I think for the time being, I would say for me, oil is not so much, it's very dependent upon other factors. And again, always remember that oil is very connected to GDP and generally the amount of economic activity that's out there. And for the time being, the fundamentals in the US, one of the biggest oil consumers, are fairly flat. Most oil demand is coming out of China and the emerging markets. So I think overall it's quite balanced, but I mean, oil is likely to be very sensitive to market events. So if we see kind of risk off events, and again, kind of more negativity and kind of more dollar demand and more and risk of trading decisions, and oil is likely to fall from on further from here. Going back to always remember that a very good comparison is 2008, because some of the circumstances that are now happening now in terms of credit spreads, in terms of how markets are reacting to the sovereign debt problem, is very similar to what happened in around when Lehman Brothers went down in 2008. So we saw wider credit spreads, tight funding markets, and essentially a lot of market uncertainty, a lot of volatility. Now, a similar situation is potentially going to happen now. And if that's the case, oil is going to suffer, and is likely to sell off quite rapidly off the highs here. So, I mean, long positions, I would be, again, similar to gold, I'd be very hesitant on long positions, although a short position would be the way to go if you believe that the macroeconomic kind of news that you're kind of seeing at the moment are not are going to deteriorate, because for the time, the moment, as we saw this week, and the problem in Europe's actually, well, I would say, got worse since the week before. I mean, although markets haven't reacted as such that very strongly to that, but all the tensions are still there and all the uncertainty is still there. So for me, oil is more of a seller's market at the moment, and I would be very tentative to go long. Okay, let's just have a look at if there's any other questions. Just a quick question from Alex Bagnar. Let's say that the price is approaching from above, so approaching a support level from above. How would you plan your trade? Do you buy right when the price hits the level? Do you let the price overshoot the level and return above the level and then buy? If neither one of these, then please specify. Thank you. What Alex is referring to is a very common strategy whereby essentially trading breakouts. So you're looking to find a resistance or a support level and looking to trade the breakout or the bounce of that level. So just give you an example of how that would look like. So again, let me just pull up a chart quickly. One second. So let's just take the dollar Swiss pair. I mean, this can be any pair. I'm just picking a dollar Swiss for randomly. This doesn't have to be. I mean, this applies to every single product, really. So so if we just take I'll just get rid of all these moving averages quickly. So, for example, let's say you're looking at this currency pair, and let's say you've identified a particular level that you believe is to be a strong resistance level. So, let's say we've identified 92.90. So, this level here as a 1 second. So, let's say we've identified this level right there as a resistance level, and let's say, and as you can see here, the price is currently approaching this level. So for example, what you'd be looking to do in this situation is in Alex's example, is he would be looking to, let's say, take a short position somewhere around here, and he would be waiting for the price to rise up, touch that level, and either come back down or trade straight through. And essentially, so for example, if you believe that level to hold, if you think that level is going to be strong enough to, i.e., there are more sellers than buyers at this level, and thus the price will fall back, then you're looking to take a short position. And if you think that price is going to break through, you're probably looking to take a long position, either just before the level or soon after the level. Now, the reason why for me, in response to Alex's question, the reason why for me this is neither one of these approaches essentially is very efficient is that because, well, either one of two things can happen. So if you're going short here and you think the level will hold, it may not. And vice versa. So essentially, you're still taking a 50-50 chance, because you're looking at that level, and there's not so much information to give you really strong conviction of that level or not. That is why, for me, breakout strategies are, in my personal experience trading, and also looking at speaking to various other clients trading, is that breakout strategies don't tend to work over the longer term. I.e., you do really have to do something slightly more. Slightly more sophisticated in terms of to make it more successful over time. In answer to the question, would you let the price overshoot and return above the level and then buy, or do you buy when the price hits the level? I would say not necessarily do either. I would more or less remember that in foreign exchange, a price can actually go beyond the level by a good 30 or 40 points and then go back through that level. So, and then when you look back on that chart, let's say a week later, you will think that level actually held, but maybe if anything, it wasn't necessarily a level. But what you actually find is a lot of these levels, like for example, this 92.90, it's not necessarily a level, but it could actually be a zone of, let's say, 92.90 and 93 there below, like that. It could actually be a zone. So it could actually be a 10 pip zone, or sometimes even a 30 pip zone, where you essentially, what you're looking for is confirmation of that level failing or holding before you take a position, and the confirmation of the level holding or not is not necessarily in the price. So, for example, if the price trades through this level, it doesn't mean that the level is broken. The level is broken when market participants looking at this currency pair, think it's broken, essentially. And this goes back to the psychology of trading, as going back to the seminar that I did on Tuesday, and that essentially markets only behave the way they do because of people's perceptions of that market, not for any other reason. You know, these are all just numbers. These are all just candlesticks. At the end of the day, that other market participants are looking at the same chart, looking at the same level, and they will be making decisions just like you. So essentially, I would be looking. So again, to finally answer this question, I would say that whenever, if I was to trade a breakout strategy, and I'm trading support or resistance levels, I'll be looking to find some kind of confirmation that level is either held or broken, and go long or short. Not necessarily even on that level, but once I know for sure the level is broken, and the way you know for sure, or with a higher level of assuredness, is if the level is retested. So once the market has gone through this level, if it then comes back and retests it, then you know that's kind of, i.e. there are now buyers there to support that level, and so it's likely to move higher from here, or vice versa. If the level has held several times, not just once, but if this upside, the resistance level, if it's held several times and then it comes back down, then that's also a good indicator that it's held. And also more generally, the one other quick point is that on the time frame itself. So the longer the time frame you're working with, the more stronger the signal, i.e. the stronger that the level is. So for example, we're looking here on a daily time frame. So from my personal opinion, the 9290 level will be a strong level. For example, if today we reach there, it's not impossible at all that we reach there today or tomorrow. So by the end of this week, so if dollar yen, if we see more dollar strength by the end, this week, we probably are likely to see a slowdown of that strength around 92.90, and potentially a reversal back down towards around 86. Because I think at the end of the day, for the time being, we are kind of seeing ranging markets for more or less, especially in currency pairs like dollar Swiss, dollar yen, because those currencies are the safest. We're in a safe haven environment at the moment, so generally. Market participants are looking at these pairs with fairly equal measure. And so for me, considering the currency pair this is, dollar Swiss, considering that it's a daily time frame, and considering that a lot of currency pairs are preferring to stay in ranges whilst uncertainty is kind of resolved around the world in various different locations, for me it will be a fairly strong level to trade. So I would be probably looking to take short positions on this level and looking for it to hold. Although, if it does break through 92.90, I'll be waiting for it to retest that level, or some other factor, maybe in the market, maybe a fundamental factor elsewhere, will suggest to me that is a good long position to take. But always look for, whenever trading anything, whether you're trading breakout strategies or anything else, try and look for confirmations and for some kind of factor that gives you extra confidence, not just a simple buy or sell on a particular level. Okay, let me just see if there's any other questions. I mean, yeah. If you have any more questions, guys, I'm more than happy to answer them. If not, I'll just give you a few more minutes. If not, then I think we'll wrap this up here. And if you do have, by the way, if you do have any questions, just do at a later time. Just by all means, email them to us. You should have an email in your inboxes as a reminder for this webinar. So if that's, I don't see any more questions. So that's about it. So thank you very much for listening, and good luck in your trading. Thank you.